Module 9, The Common Foundation of Fact and Fiction. This module is built on a very simple, but I think a powerful idea, that if you want to understand what really happened in the 20th century, you don't have to read the newspapers. What you need to do is read the fiction, because the tales that are real find their way into the fiction of the 20th century. Let's explore that idea. The scholars who write in the Encyclopedia Britannica talk about American literature on this slide. American literature shaped by the history of the country. Meanwhile, the rise of science and industry, as well as changes in the ways of thinking and feeling, wrought many modifications in people's lives. All these factors in the development of the United States molded literature of the country, and so it was with the 20th century. Real life in the 20th century affected romantic novels, action novels, science fiction writing. It affected all of these. Now, let me tell you at the outset, when I talk about literature, I want to include all aspects of literature. I want to include screenplays. I want to include dramas and comedies. I want to include music. I want to include all of those expressive elements of literature in the 20th century. So remember that as we go. Now, writers and readers affect each other. Obviously, writers are attentive to what readers like in terms of character and style and all the others. And the readers respond to the writers as well. They develop an appetite for characters, for personalities, for conflicts that come in the literature. And that's what we saw in the 20th century. Readers react differently because of what the writers record. These are six remarkable writers. In the lower left-hand corner, you see Truman Capote, who we'll talk about, Ida M. Tarbell above him. In the upper left-hand corner, Rod Serling, the magnificent writer and dramatist who gave us The Twilight Zone. John Steinbeck in the center, and to the center of the entire slide, Lorraine Hansberry at the top, and down at the bottom, we have Lillian Hellman, and all of these writers brought their life stories, brought their experiences of the 20th century into their writing in ways that we'll find right now. Steinbeck gave us magnificent views of the Dust Bowl and the Depression in The Grapes of Wrath, shown a movie here with Henry Fonda and Jane Darwell. He also gave us Of Mice and Men, a very powerful study of two men drifting along during the Depression, Lenny and George. George was the bright one. Lenny, in this case played by Lon Chaney, was developmentally disabled and given to occasional violence. They were helping each other through the Depression. Steinbeck was telling us through the characters the only way for us to get through the Depression was to help each other. That common traditional gospel message was illustrated powerfully in the story of Mice and Men, and also in the story of the Jodes and all the people they traveled with. Now, a different kind of story was the story of Lifeboat. This film actually came out, I think, late in 1943, during the middle of the war. And Steinbeck's wife didn't like him writing for the film too much because she thought that was a little cheap. But he wrote this for good old Alfred Hitchcock, and it's one of my favorite movies. It tells the story of these American and Allied people who are ship went down, and they're on this lifeboat. And then they fish out this German sailor, who they suspect at the beginning might be the captain of the German U-boat who scuttled their ship. But they find out later their suspicions were right. Steinbeck has this great sense of character, this great sense of intimacy that he brings to all of his stories. Now, Ida M. Tarbell is one of those few people I talk about in this module who wrote in nonfiction. Her classic 1902 work, The Study of the Standard Oil Company, was really a devastating portrayal of this corporation and how it treated American business and how it treated American consumers. She set the gold standard for investigative journalism early in the 20th century. Now, Lillian Hellman, like all writers, relies on her own experience. Her family growing up in Alabama had a business, and the business and its success created contention and conflict in the family. She created a play. It was done on stage to great success. It later was converted to film with Betty Davis in this leading role. It is, as the item says here, greed, power, money, family, all of those things that are human nature in the 20th century manifest in this story by Lillian Hellman. Now, this is a story of a terrible murder, set of murders in western Kansas, out in Holcomb, Kansas. Perry and Hickok were a couple of criminals who got out of the penitentiary, state penitentiary down in Lansing, and stole a couple cars, made their way out to western Kansas because one of their cellmates said that Herb Clutter, this farmer out there, had a safe with money in it. And so they went out there and were very disappointed when they broke into the Clutter house and Herb Clutter had about $30 and no safe. Well, these guys, much frustrated, went ahead and killed all the Clutters in a most brutal way. Well, this was reported, this terrible, brutal house invasion was reported in the newspapers, and Capote's editors at the magazine back east sent him out to explore, see whether there's a story in it. He brought one of his best friends along, herself a gifted writer by the name of Harper Lee. You recognize that because of her work in writing To Kill a Mockingbird. The two of them came out to Kansas. They befriended the Kansas Bureau of Investigation agent. They befriended the local cops, despite the fact they were sort of an odd pair from the East. Capote got completely absorbed by this story, and he turned out this magnum opus in cold blood, which I really encourage you to read. It is a fabulous book. It is a book in which he really creates and develops a style of nonfiction fiction. He tells the story, including lots of interviews with Perry and Hickok, tells the story and fills in the dialogue and fills in the scenes that he couldn't know nor anybody else know. But it gives us a very dramatic and very tragic portrayal. Unfortunately, the last victim of this was Capote himself. He became so absorbed with the work that while he did write a little after this, his grand genius was spent in this book in cold blood. Again, a true story of the 20th century turned into a work of fiction. Well, Lorraine Hansberry, like Lillian Hellman, wrote the story about how money affects a family, except Lorraine Hansberry, growing up in racially segregated Woodlawn neighborhood in Chicago. It's a case where the family, I think they received a life insurance check or something, some family member died, and they received, I don't know, $10,000. It was a very successful play. She was the first African-American author to have a play produced on Broadway. And it was also turned into a film. And she took the title from a work by Langston Hughes, Raisin in the Sun. It's a great book, it's a great play, and a terrific movie, but it tells a story of racial segregation. It tells a story about limited expectations. It tells a story about how money changes a family. And that is a universal story for a lot of people in the 20th century. Now, Rod Serling, again in the upper left-hand corner, created The Twilight Zone. This wonderfully bizarre late 50s, early 60s television series. And the tales that he told were really parables. Some of them were political commentary. For example, down the lower left-hand corner, you see these people, and it's all about the monster on Maple Street and what they imagine and how they turn against one another. Here's John Daly right next to them on the phone, and he plays a very compulsive advertising executive for whom it's a push, push, push business, and he has a brutal end. Speaking of brutal ends, at the top, the middle, you see face masks, horrible, grotesque mask given to the family of this guy who was dying. And he said that you will get none of my inheritance unless you wear these masks until midnight. And of course, midnight he dies and they take their masks off. But I'll let you watch that story. Finally, I want to talk to you a little bit about this one because I have a video clip I'm going to play. It's called Time Enough at Last. It will follow this slide immediately. Here's Burgess Meredith, who you may know from Rocky and lots of other movies. Burgess Meredith was a very meek, mild fellow who loved to read and whose wife hated his reading. He would come home and if he had a book of poetry hidden away, she would scratch through it and write out all the poems. She would take his newspapers. So he carried a book with him to work. And he's sitting there at the counter of the bank, making change and doing the transactions, reading the book. And it's lunchtime. He grabs his book, grabs his lunch, goes like three levels down to the vault. Because there in the vault, he's safe. There's no distractions. He can read. Very early in the play, the vault shakes. He goes upstairs and finds out there's been an atomic attack and everybody is dead. First idea is to go home and see if his wife is still there. The apartment is gone. The wife is gone. He finds a car that still runs. He drives around. He finds some food. And then, as he's just about ready to take his own life for frustration and loneliness, he finds the library. And here he is, sitting in the library. And this is the scene that you will see here in just a minute. And we'll see how the play ends. And it, of course, is a parable by Rod Serling about anti-intellectualism. There are so many people in that time, and still in our time, who demean intellectuals, who demean those who read and look to expand their horizons and their intelligence. So let's watch now this clip from Time Enough at Last.
Works of Dickens, collected works of George Bernard Shaw, poems by Browning, Shelley, Keats, great dramas of the world, books, all the books I'll need, all the books I'll ever want, Shelley, Shakespeare, Shaw, all the books I want. All the books. January, February, March, April, May. This year, the next year, and the year after that, and the year after that. And the best thing, the very best thing of all,
is there's time now. There's all the time I need and all the time I want. Time, time, time. Ah, there's time enough at last. That's not fair. That's not fair at all. There was time now. There was all the time I needed. That's not fair. That's not fair.
The best laid plans of mice and men, and Henry Bemis. The small man in the glasses who wanted nothing but time. Henry Bemis, now just a part of a smashed landscape. Just a